Hello everybody and welcome to this presentation on clarinet choirs. I'm Barbara Heilmair. I teach clarinet and music history at Portland State University in Oregon. And today I will be talking about how we can foster this idiomatic blend of chamber music and large ensemble skills that we find in clarinet choirs. So I'm very happy that you have found your way to this presentation, and it is really intended for directors and also for participants who are playing in a clarinet choir to give you some ideas on how to rehearse and what to do with the music. So I'm here to give you some ideas and suggestions, and let's plunge right into it. So first, to give you a little bit of my background in directing clarinet choirs and also clarinet ensembles. So since I've started at Portland State University, which is quite a while ago, I have been working with ensembles of all sizes, from duet basically through trios, quartets, and so forth, up to the fully fleshed clarinet choir. And in 2017, after a phase of preparation, we have founded a large clarinet choir, and it's called the Clarinet Choir here in Portland, with really the entire clarinet family present and presented in there. So I've also received some invitations as a guest coach with other groups. And one of the peak moments was certainly in 2019 with Chamber Music Northwest, when we had a colossal clarinet choir with over 100 clarinetists, and we played out in the park, and I got to teach a piece, and it was really quite the experience. And there's more to come. We have plans, and clarinet choir is really a wonderful means for fostering musicality. So for today's considerations, I want to give you an overview that really the point is that working with clarinet choirs is something that is very special, very idiomatic, and we have elements from other types of music, from other types of groups. So we find elements in clarinet choir that are coming more from a large ensemble setting, as in wind band or even orchestra. We also find some elements that are more from chamber music playing and literature. So we will see that both the playing practices and what type of piece, what type of literature we have in front of us will influence that, how we play. So these come together as a special mix, and that I will describe that as well. And we will also have some summarizing thoughts, and I'll show you a slide about the sources that I've been using for this. First, for those of you who might be newer to clarinet choir, it typically has the larger clarinet family presented. So we have E flat clarinet, B flat and A, alto or basset horn, bass clarinet, contra alto, and contra bass. And they are depicted here on the right. Of course, the clarinet family has more instruments, but you might not find them typically in a clarinet choir, for example, clarinet in D or clarinet in C, or the Mozart clarinet, which is the A clarinet with an extended foot, extended lower joint. So those are not typically to be found in a clarinet choir, but the ones that I've put here, they are in there usually. So let's look at some of these idiomatic features that I mentioned before that we find in this type of group. So above all, we have a very special sound and instrumentation in the clarinet choir that is very diverse, and you can do pedagogically and musically so many things with it. It's very rich. The main phenomenon may be that it's a very monochromatic setting. So we really have in concert style the same tone color with variations present. So they're all clarinets, but because they're all different sizes, different bores, they have different colors. And each member of the clarinet family really has a different character to itself, and that's why composers wrote different pieces depending for different clarinets depending on their character. And one might even say that certain types from the family lend themselves more to certain styles and some less. For example, I've heard saying, for example, for klezmer, particularly the regular clarinet B flat or A, and bass clarinet, they seem to be really working well also for jazz, while in symphonic, in for example, symphonic poems by Strauss, the pointy sound of an E flat or D clarinet work particularly well. So composers have since a long time really recognized and understood that each of them are quite different and can do different things. Now, here's a little bit more to this idiomatic setting, but it has more to do with what we can learn in this group. Of course, in every group we can learn so many things that teach so many things, but the particular thing about clarinet choirs is that you can practically do everything. You can address general concepts, you can learn how can learn intonation, play with others. I will address this more later, but there's one thing that you really can't do so much, and that is learning how to play with other instruments, brass or strings, that is really not in there. And the clarinet ensembles can vary in sizes. It really depends on who is there and what instruments are available. It may be that somebody's in a setting where you don't have the contralto clarinet or an alto, and then things have to happen. For example, if an alto is missed, one can move some of the B flat players and transpose the parts and so forth. The important thing here to really keep in mind is that the focus, the musical focus of a piece, whether it's going to be more a chamber music setting or a larger ensemble setting, will depend on the composition. What is really in the work? And I will later give some examples to show you what I really mean by that. We'll be very specific. Clarinet choirs don't really have a standard instrumentation, but as I said before, because it depends on the piece and on the players available, but we can observe sort of an optimum or very frequent instrumentation, and it would consist of these instruments. So you would ideally have one E flat clarinet, 12 B flats, that's quite a bit. Not everybody would have those, but it's wonderful to have that kind of a staffing. One alto, one bass, and one contrabass, which could in some pieces be a contra alto, and this number here could also vary. This instrumentation, this setup would give you a very nice balance, and many arrangements or original compositions have been written with a sound in mind that would be with these instruments. Usually in this mix of elements from large and small ensembles, it would be ideal to have a clarinetist conduct this group, because they are really most familiar with the workings of a clarinet. Of course, it is nice to have a guest conductor, for example, in a Mahler transcription, if one looks really for this musical approach of a conductor that is used to symphonic music. But ideally, really, a clarinetist, in my opinion, would be the best director. And this leads us to the next point. Here's an example of how a setting could look like. This is one moment of my group here in Portland, the Zephyr Clarinet Choir, how we are seated. This is one of the times when we, in our standards, were a relatively small group. We sometimes had more players, and we were also seated a little bit differently. But at this point, I already would like to point out that we are usually seated in a half-arched or half-circle setting. So we're working with a conductor, but we also have visual contact. At this point, I just want to give a very brief overview of the history of the clarinet choir, maybe for those of you who are not familiar with it yet. But the point of this presentation is not the history. It's more to illustrate that clarinet choirs are a really serious and important means of musical expression, and they have become really the educational medium as well. So things started in Brussels with Gustave Poncelet, and he at the time already had about 27 players in his group, and this is today considered as really the start of this movement. And then later, Simeon Bellison with the New York Philharmonic, he was principal clarinetist, founded the first professional clarinet choir in the United States, and he had about 75 players, and that was really a big effect. And he had the add-on instruments, percussion, double string bass, and one hears of palm tree, stage props, and really exciting things. Here in the United States, also Harvey Herman, then with the University of Illinois Clarinet Choir, became very renowned for his work and for his what he has done with the movement. And today, the clarinet choirs are established worldwide, and we see them at many venues, and we have original compositions and also proponents of this genre across the world. Now let's look back at the skills that are that we can teach in clarinet choir. And there are some skills that are really common to any ensemble, and even similar to what we just can learn when we're learning an instrument. So we would say this is what we learn when we play solo or when we play the instrument. And this is all about technique, position, movement, tone production, how we articulate, how to practice, and what's going on in the brain and in music when we are learning and playing. So all this can be improved and learned in clarinet choirs. And also, of course, the musical concepts, phrasing, rhythm, patterns, dynamics, a lot about tuning and intonation, blending, and the musical styles, for sure. The typical chamber music elements that we can see in a clarinet choir would be a cooperative learning, that musicians communicate with each other and actively shape their musical vision together. Typically without conductor, and certainly with fewer parts overall. Mostly in chamber music, you can see one player per part. One could find oneself in a small section, for example, in an octet, where you have two clarinets, but then it's clarinet one and two, and you have just one player per part. And one will listen across the ensemble for other parts, and they are usually close by and in sight for small chamber ensembles. The sound there will be mostly based on featuring individuality on individual parts and colors and how they are blending together and how they're coming out being a solo or being intertwined with some middle parts. So it's about individuality a little bit more in chamber groups. The overall sound will be dedicated to originally to a small hall with a relatively small audience. So this is more like an intimate setting. And one can practice and learn a lot about blending, balancing, highlighting some parts, and again, tuning and intonation. Larger ensemble settings are also, or elements are also in the clarinet choir, and those are usually, when we're in a larger group, this is more a collaborative learning. So we are learning from the others and from the environment, but it is with conductors. So there is no rehearsal, no verbal communication, and usually also not really visual cues from moving together. In a chamber ensemble, one would move more together. So it is, for players, it's an opportunity to learn to play with conductor. It's a thing in its own. And usually there's a large number of parts in a big group, and one may have several players per part, depending what type of literature it is. One could be in a small section, mini section or large section, woodwinds or high register section, depending on the context. And one would certainly listen across the ensemble, but those could be parts that are further away and not in sight. Usually for large ensembles, and especially for wind bands or wind ensembles, there's this concept of a pyramid of sound that has some alterations and has been much discussed in the especially the pedagogy literature. So for a clarinet choir, there would be some add-ons to this or some ideas on how to really best work this concept. One thing is certainly very specifically for E-flat clarinets that you usually just have one and that you're trying to have a really nice and solid lower section. While it may also happen that a clarinet choir needs a middle section that is not too weak, you also want this to be really well rounded. For large ensembles, this is catered to a large hall with a big audience, and again, blending, balancing, tuning, and intonation can be learned in there. There are elements in there. Now let's listen to some music examples. And before I describe how everything ties in together, I'll give you a bit of an overview. So we will be listening to Gustav Holst's First Suite in E-flat for Military Band, Movement 1, Chaconne. And the first example is the original wind band setting with score. The second one will be clarinet quartet, and the third one will be a clarinet choir version. So in this recording, we will hear the Cleveland Symphonic Winds under Frederick Fennell performing the Chaconne from Gustav Holst's First Suite in E-flat for Military Band. So, in this wind band setting, we can really hear this basically four-part texture. For a wind band setting, I would say that is a thin texture, four parts from the beginning, and varying instruments are playing at the beginning, and it's like a chorale style almost with soprano, alto, tenor, bass, and we hear this theme in variations throughout. So this opening passage is really chamber music. We have some inserts where you have some rhythm and harmonies inserted from percussion and low brass. We are reminded occasionally that this is a wind band, but the essence of this opening passage is chamber music. Now we will compare this with a transcription. And this transcription is a clarinet quartet version. So it's a transposition by or transcription by KP Hauser. Same piece, opening, and we will be listening to a recording by a student group who call themselves the Three Stands a Piece Ensemble, and we will hear the opening played by four clarinets. So the four parts from multiple instruments are here heard on just four clarinets from the clarinet family. So, about this clarinet quartet version, we can really hear how the piece also sounds wonderful on four different clarinets. It fits the chamber music setting extremely well because it is chamber music. And we can see in this recording how the musicians communicate visually with their movements, how they are trading parts, how they really pass the musical material along very nicely, and because there's no conductor and it works so well and sounds absolutely beautiful. With the next slide, you will see this is going to be the version for clarinet choir. Same piece, opening of the chaconne, and we will hear the Northwest Clarinet Choir conducted by William Blaney. And you will hear that with this larger group, we are now adding back in from having recognized this is chamber music. It can be done with four, but we are adding in the dimension of large ensemble. And it adds, I can already tell you ahead, so much depth to it. So here we are at this blend that I've been talking about before of chamber music and wind ensemble or large ensemble that we can find in the clarinet choir. Let's give it a listen. You have heard how it all comes together. So both the chamber music and the large group are coming through, and they are coming really together in the clarinet choir. We have a conductor who manages the crowd, who manages all those parts and gives cues, because musicians cannot see each other, so they move less. But that is also, the conductor is so important because he or she is also the musical coach. And then you can see that there are several rows, so it might be really not possible to have a seating where everybody can see each other. The players in the back, usually you cannot see them. So this is really a moment where the clarinet choir can show how special a medium it is. And so we have the collaborative learning. We have either one or more per part, and everybody is listening to either close by or far away in the group. So for coaches or for participants, the blending will be really an important topic, and I would say it would be probably a good idea to really keep thinking about the chamber music element. I think once the conductor is there and kind of takes over the musical, creating the musical vision with more instructional type, it would be still very good for the players to remember if a piece has chamber music elements. I remember some orchestral rehearsals when a conductor would say to the woodwinds, play chamber music. So, and that's how they are seated, flute, oboe, clarinet, bassoon, French horn somewhere nearby, to always listen to those parts. And in a passage, is this something, which part is important right now, and which role does it have, and how is it supposed to sound like in terms of balance? The special opportunity in the clarinet choir is really for players who want to learn that all instruments of the clarinet family are included, and that the issues of playing are common to everybody. So everybody understands each other, and a coach or a conductor can speak to all of them about clarinet related topics or issues of playing. So the clarinet choir is actually a very, very efficient tool to teach pretty much everything, but especially the clarinet. So to finish this, I would like to show you that there were these two articles that I mainly did a revisitation. I read them again and included some information atop, and also the YouTube links that I have used are directly provided in this presentation. So I hope you were able to get some ideas and inspiration out of this presentation. Thank you for listening to this. And if you have any questions or would like to contact me, if you Google Portland State University and my name, Barbara Heilmair, I'm pretty sure you will find me. Have a great rest of your conference, and thank you so much again for listening. Bye.